Hi, good morning everyone. So today's talk is on our effort, what we are doing on Open Power ISA system on chip design curriculum. So this is the ongoing work. So I would be giving the overview why we have we started this project or project, and then what is our plan and what are we doing it currently, and then what we want to be. So this is the crux. This will be the crux of my talk. Feel free if you have questions. Okay. Myself, let me introduce myself. Myself, Abhinandan. I'm an associate professor at NIE Mysore, and also I'm an IBM Power Champion for this year. So this is the topic that I'm going to give the talk. So let us see. Just I will give you the outline of my talk. So the first and foremost, we will see what the system on chip means, and then how the market and applications we have with respect to SoC, and what is really driving SoC at this point of time. And then we will present our idea of concept to application, and then what is the relationship between ISA and SoC, and then the crux, what is our goal, what are our proposed outcomes, and then what is the curriculum that we are actually providing, and then as part of curriculum, our virtual labs, and then finally an update or a report on ongoing curriculum program that we have started, but that we are running from a couple of days. So as you are aware, system on chip is an integrated circuit, okay, that actually tightly couples microprocessor, microcontrollers, and peripherals. Basically, if we have seen our desktop version, right, we have a motherboard and we have different peripherals, and we would connect it. But in SoC, this is still a micro integrated circuit, but instead of scattering it and then having a connection outside the board, we make provision the board, inside the IC board, and we do the interconnection, and then we'll use it. And one simple example, even if you see, right, current SoC is not only limited to embedded and consumer electronics, but now you could see Apple's M1 chip is one example of SoC. So the whole idea is we do have different components, memory and all those things, and we actually integrate it on one board. And this is one example of Raspberry Pi we have. So according to Gartner, global SoC market is expected to be worth 205.4 billion in another 2 years. And if you see the compounded annual growth rate from 2017, it is 8.1%. So every year there is a positive growth with respect to SoC adoption. And what is driving it is embedded and IoT devices, and the major market segments we have is our consumer electronics, telecommunication, and automotive industry. So and now the IoT devices are very cheap, right? So for $100 you would get small FPGA boards, and then we do get devices that can monitor our fitness. So at the end of the day, these all have a set of sensors which are actually tightly coupled on within an integrated circuit. So basically, we can actually safely consider that as a small SoC. So all the devices that are able to connect to internet and do some kind of little processing, most of them are actually built using SoC. So what is driving? What is the driving factor beyond the SoC adoption? So compactness. So it is very compact, right? So we are seeing small form factors. The reason is all the components within all those components can be mounted on the same chip, and then the IoT adoption, right? Now, across the world, the network communication is becoming cheap and it is highly penetrated. So with the even with the adopt with the pandemic and all those things, we moved from offline to online, even in academics, which was not the case earlier. So and with the lot of adoption of network penetration of networking, we are finding very different and novel use cases. And then on top of that, the cloud adoption, right? If you go and talk with any enterprise, it has become a de facto standard to move their resource into a cloud. So most of them would be having their private cloud, and some of the big companies would actually have their own cloud and provide services to the customers. So, and not only that, with the adoption of cloud, we are finding new paradigms. Which are not only theoretical in nature, but they are being applied really. So for instance, edge computing, right? So if you take the edge computing, we do have a Microsoft Azure box where you keep a part of processing data storage or processing at the customer location, so that you reduce the load on the cloud. At the same time, you improve the responsiveness of the application. So and edge and fog are no longer theoretical in nature, they are reality. So these are the things, this is another thing that is widely improving IoT adoption, right? The smart watches in our wrist can communicate with the cloud. So that's the connectivity we are having. And then suddenly we are seeing a surge in smart and power efficient devices, right? So if you see the mobile phones, right, every generation every 6 months, every release is becoming power efficient. At the same time, the computing capacity is also improving tremendously. So the mobile devices that what we have are much powerful than what we used to see the desktop computers in early 90s. So this enables to run the task very fast and power efficient. So then what is concept to application? What is actually driving the, why we need SOC in that space? So let us say that, we were fine with software, but we want to run everything on the hardware because of efficiency, right? So we can actually have a layer on top of the hardware, and then we can mimic and all those things. But running on real hardware is more efficient. And if you see the trend in machine learning, we are trying to deploy pre-trained models on the FPGAs. So you could see even though the software is going forward, it needs to be synced with hardware. And there is a saying, right? So any software is as good as its hardware, right? So the whole idea is, okay, I have some requirements, I do have my concept, and how can I design the SoC, custom SoC? And for that, generally, for example, would be library SoC, right? In library SoC, internally uses library SoC uses LaTeX. So basically, you have a LaTeX core ecosystem and MIGEN and NMIGEN, where actually you give your specifications, and then you do have PGA tool chain, and you specify your board and target, and the LaTeX would actually give you the design. So this is what we talk about, the concept to application scenario, right? You have something in your mind, you do have want to have a designs, right? So you have thought, okay, I want to develop an application that can run on FPGA. So we actually come up with our requirement, saying that, okay, I need this component and this capability. And then I want to run on specified board, and then the target hardware, and I use those informations, and using LaTeX, I could generate the design. So this is what we we actually talk a mean concept application. And one simple and well-known example is Liber SoC. So in Liber SoC, if you see, right, it uses LaTeX, all LaTeX and NMI gen. So, and then we get the design, and this GDS design, we actually can give directly to the fabrication. So then what is the relationship between the instruction set architecture and SoC? As we aware, right, instruction set defines the CPU. What are the core functionalities, what are the functionalities that the CPU supports is specified by the instruction set. And we can safely say that instruction set architecture is the building block for SoC. Without instruction set, we cannot have an SoC. Because when we talk about SoC, it is not only a one component, it's a CPU with a computing capability, and then we do have other components which are tightly integrated. Okay, so then what are our goals with this curriculum? Why we thought we want to develop a Power ISA SoC design curriculum? So the first and foremost is to create the momentum among the technical community about the power architecture. Actually, even though power architecture is also as old as x86 architecture, but it is not much popular among the masses. So that's the reason we wanted to create the momentum. If you ask any random normal non-technical user, you talk about the processor, a few things come to my their mind is x86. We want to create and take the techno the architecture to the mass. So that's the reason we wanted to create the momentum, and then we wanted to stimulate the interest with the usage of open power instruction set, because it is really open, right? What are the applications that I can easily, using open power ISA, I can develop my application basically without paying any royalty. And then we want to make the learners to feel confident and then ease in designing FPGA based systems. And not only that, so the two things here. See, it is like an academy. We know, right, academy and industry. So the power started by the industry, and we want the academicians to adopt the course and then use those things to teach computer architecture and organization. And not only that, we want to see with these risk-based ISA, we want to disseminate the concept and adopt in the regular engineering curriculum. If you see India one of the large number of student community for engineering. And not only that, who pursue masters are Indians and Chinese. So here we want to bring the courses at the level of bachelors, so the people are aware and know why people have to use risk-based processors, especially the power ISA. So that was our goal. And then what is our proposed outcome? Right. So in order to build the ecosystem, it is absolutely necessary to partner with the academicians and academic institutions and go and introduce those concepts, imbibe those concepts, those tools with the students so that once they pass out, they become the developers, most of them, and then you actually see this developer community and then build the ecosystem. So that is the one outcome we have in our mind. And not only that, we want the learners to use the Power Scrolls flexibly with various open source tools, and we want them to get trained in Open Power course, and then especially for the freshers to initiate, to build and to master the chip design, empower them, a course, a chip, a day. So we do have the courses in VLSI structures, VLSI, but we want to include these things to bridge the gap between the industry and academia. So what is the what are the key concepts in the curriculum that we are going to teach? See, here we are assuming we are not only limiting the students to know only electronics, but we are fine with computer science graduates also to take up the course in VLSI design. So for that, we have a prerequisites. In prerequisites, most of the computer science graduates would not have worked at the hardware level. So they would have experience in working till design drivers, but how exactly the hardware, they would actually know about the high level logic design, gates and all those things, but they generally will not have an exposure to go deeper, go deep into the hardware. So this is a little bit deeper. So we want them to understand and understand the core aspects, the basics in the hardware. So for that, we do have a prerequisite. And then we have a system Verilog perspective. How the system Verilog works, and then its reference manual. And then we actually teach them the concept of IP verification. So basic questions that we actually deal are, what is IP? What do we mean by IP? And then how the flow of the stimulus in IP verification environment look? And then what are the different test bench automation techniques generally used in the IP verification by the industry? So, and then we have SOC verification. So basically, what are the components, like what are the basic building blocks of SOC verification, and then the stimulus in verification environment. So that one is an IP verification, this one is a SOC verification, and then different automation techniques in SOC. And not only that, we teach the fundamentals of SOC design, components, and then how SOCs are connected and integrated, which is very much important. Then we actually teach the fundamentals of FPGA, and then porting and programming, and finally the backend design. This is how our theoretical course curriculum look like. So, and as a part of the curriculum, we do have a virtual Yeah, you are right. IP is an intellectual property. So the basically what happens is that we are building SOC, right? Sometimes we might have to use different components. So that's the reason we have to do the IP verification. Yeah. So the virtual labs. So that the two slides actually spoke about the effect and there is a saying, right? You need to have an hands-on experience, right? Whatever we teach should have an hands-on experience. Until unless you have the hands-on experience, the concept cannot properly. You that only if the student participate and do some hands-on small coding, even though it is confidence in saying that okay, that we know some concepts and then apply some of those concepts what they have learned and see how it works by themselves. So essentially, the labs will help students to understand the big picture and then nitty-gritty details of the concept. So that's the reason and the unique feature of our curriculum is that okay, labs are the unique feature of our curriculum. So we actually use virtual labs. So this is our FPGA remote lab overview. So what we do is we do have a student PC which actually connects to RDP Vivad over internet through VPN and SSH tunnels. And we do have a server farm in University of Oregon, where we actually use the FPGA and the logic analyzers. You see here, right? This is how, you connect to the data center network through SSH and VPN. And then you connect to the server through RDP, and then you actually start Vivado and then download the bitstream, and then you can give the input through VO, or you can observe the internal and external signals through logical analyzer. This is how our virtual labs look like. And this is our infrastructure for virtual lab. So we do have a server with the following software, Xilinx, Vivado, X2Go, SigRock, or a logical analyzer tool like SigRock. We have a webcam client, and then we have a user ID per student. And we do have a VPN gateway. So through this, the student can connect to our data center network. And the hardware we have connected Xilinx FPGA development board like RTA700T to the server. For every student, we have an FPGA development board, a basic logical analyzer, a webcam to view the board, and then you have a sensors or actuators connected to FPGA development board. So these are per student. And another lab we have is two lab. And tomorrow we are going to give the demo on Curlist to lab, giving access to 400 students tomorrow in final day of our training, FTP training that we have started two weeks back in IIT Guwahati. Basically, Curlist 2 is built on University of Oregon servers. We have enabled 400 students who can generate GDS 2 files using library SOC full components or partial components. And this is a screenshot that we have. In Oregon system is up and running with the Curlist 2, and this was mainly due to the help from library SOC, especially Lou.
So there were two teams who were working on the curriculum part, another one is lab part simultaneously from past 4 months. And they have devoted a lot of time in that. So this is Karolis 2 is really an resource hungry platform actually, and people have spent a lot of private time in building this tool chain on University of Oregon servers. So here the output looks like this. So this is a GDS2 file. This is a visualization. This is the GDS2 file looks like on Karolis 2, and you can use this. You can send this GDS2 file to the foundry for directly for fabrication also. So already library SoC is sent like that. So this is the virtual labs, and the Karolis 2 labs are the specialty are the unique points in our curriculum. And these are our collaborators: University of Oregon, IBM, Object Automation, which is based in Chennai, and in US, and Library SoC with Luke, and then Sorbonne University, and then IIT. And IIT Guwahati, JNTU Anandpur, TCS Research, NIT Suratkal, NIT Calicut. We provided we had a lab session supported by NIT Calicut, Calicut, Shastra University, University Chennai, and SRM. There were two parallel teams who was working on the hard on the developing the lab, also developing the soft curriculum, and they have spent time deliver a 40-hour curriculum, and the plan is to build 160-hour curriculum. We will go through it, and then. Very recently, we actually the whatever curriculum we developed for 40 hours is actually started. We started delivering from October 18th, and tomorrow is the last day. So if you see here, right? So this is an organized by IIT Guwahati, IIT Roorkee, so MNIT Jaipur, NIT Patna, and PDPM, IIIT DM Jabalpur. So these are the main institutes, and if you see. So IBM is another partner, and Digital India by it is funded by in by the statutory bodies also. So basically, this was a faculty development program for Open Power ASCII risk-based architecture. It is still going on. It was, as I told, it is organized by very good, very well-known institutions across India, and we are conducting the sessions from past 2 weeks with 422 participants, and these participants are the faculties who are spread across India. So we are training the trainers, and whatever the sessions that we have taken is on YouTube, like every day from 10 to 2 p.m. Indian time. You could see the live streaming of the sessions that we have taken, and then even those sessions are available for the offline watching, viewing also. And these are the labs we had. So basically, we had a lab which showed microwatt simulation, microwatt implementation in FPGA and application programming, and microwatt minimal SoC implementation FPGA, and then RTL to GDS OpenLANflow, and RTL to GDS Karolis to Flow. And tomorrow we have a Karolis to Flow lab. So and this microwatt lab was supported by NIT Calicut. We used their resources, and our students could log in and run microwatt programs and all those things, and then Karol is two. They are going to connect to University of Oregon servers tomorrow to generate GDF files. So if you see here, right, the whole session almost divided into two parts. In one part, we would teach theory. The other part, we would actually teach hands-on. So if we take some concept like prerequisite, so prerequisite was followed by an introduction to microvat, and then which is followed by a microvat simulation. And then we had an design, SOC design, and then we had a lab on microvat implementation in FPGA. And then we had a corresponding lab to other lab on minimum SOC implementation. And then after we thought verification, we had an open lane flow today. And tomorrow we are going to present the Karolis to flow. So that's not only that, now we have an infrastructure to handle 400 students, and thanks to the team who made it possible. And in summary, we want to see, as we know, right, there is a very good relationship between academia and industry, right? So the whole idea is, in academics, we teach fundamentals, but in industry expects the students to be readily deployable. So basically they want them to, with minimal guidance, the students should be able to pick the real things and start doing the job. But however, with the amount, no matter what, generally, there will be a gap between the academia and industry. So a lot of things as academicians, we cannot teach them because of some infrastructure issues and all those things. But certainly make them understand the fundamentals, make them strong. And then in industry, they do have infrastructure and infrastructures and but their expectation, but they do have their deliverables. So there is a gap between academia and industry with respect to the job skills. What are the job skills that the students get from their academic degree, and what is the job skills that expected by the industry? So people are working on it and reduce the gap, but here we want to bridge this open power ISA SOC design curriculum bridge a gap between the academia and industry. So in a short, our vision is to bridge the gap between industry and academia, especially in VLSA design, by offering this course as a master's course worldwide. So we don't want to restrict ourselves to be a pan-Indian attempt, but our goal is rather to spread this, provide this course worldwide. So if you see the whole reason why we took, so we started by 4 months, 3-4 months back, with the idea of building the curriculum for 160 hours, but we found an opportunity with IIT Guwahati where we thought, okay, let us see and try to deliver a miniature of 160 hours with the thought process we had, especially the labs and theory. And in academics, yes, students are well versed about the theory, but the hands-on, how the industry perceives that skill, hands-on skills, we wanted to test it out whether our approach is scalable or not. So we had a lot of questions for ourselves, and what we decided is, okay, let us give a try, let us come up with a 40-hour curriculum, one fourth of the curriculum that we have planned for, we earlier planned for 160 hours. And then, okay, let us go with a quarter of it, and see and with an emphasis on labs and see how we can actually do that. So especially this course is delivered online. It is not even the offline classes. So it is an online class, and good thing is that the audience audience, especially the faculties, they well received it, and they are insisting for more similar sessions, and more colleges are also talking with us to provide this kind of course. So please do join SOC in Hours Power Chat tutorial by our team right now. Manikandan and his team are giving a tutorial called SOC in Hours Power Chat. They would actually walk through. This is a four-hour tutorial that is planned, and they would take you through the lab sessions that we have. So it is a very good experience, and you can actually see how do you do a minimal SOC design in 4 hours. So this is the so I would end my talk. Please let me know if you have any questions. Any questions?
Hi, Abhinandan. I just wanted to say thank you to both to you and especially to Ganesan for inviting LibreSoft to be a part of this initiative. It was a great honor. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Luke. And that the lab sessions would not be possible without your involvement, and you have put a lot of efforts in that. You have spent a lot of private time, and not only that, Luke is our one of the speaker who introduced the library SOC in our FDP, and as a part of that, our goal is to work with library SOC and then build the course. We want to have library SOC as a part of our program, Luke, and thank you. You made the lab sessions feasible. We had thoughts, but you made it possible, especially the time you have spent in University of Oregon is incredible.
And that's also
I and Ganeshan actually thank you for that.
Jean-Paul Chaput's talk on Coriolis 2 is also available, I see, on the playlist.
Oh. Hi, Jean. Yeah, I also.
Fantastic.
Yeah. So, and not only that, I take this as an opportunity to thank my team members for helping us out, and then making this idea feasible and deliverable. In fact, we successfully deployed a miniature version of curriculum training in one of the prestigious institutes of national importance, IIT Guwahati. And thank you, team. And thank you, Jean, also. Thank you, Jean. Yeah.